And are you prepared to suffer the consequences that society may deem you need to suffer because of your views?
Yes, I'm prepared to do that. Well, so what am I willing to do? Well, I think that the Ontario Human Rights Tribunal is probably obligated by their own tangled web to bring me in front of it. If they find me, I won't pay it. If they put me in jail, I'll go on a hunger strike. I'm not doing this. And that's that. I'm not using the words that other people require me to use, especially if they're made up by radical left-wing ideologues.
Jordan Peterson. If you haven't heard of this man by now, well, you need to look him up. So we're seeing a lot of mixed reactions coming out of the Christian community towards this guy and his message, and I just really wanted to take a moment and share some of my own thoughts about him. As with all people, saved or unsaved, heretic or John MacArthur, I always encourage people to disregard personalities, disregard associations, disregard labels, and deal with the content. If you're unwilling or unable to do this, you really risk missing out on all kinds of powerful truths simply because of the method of delivery. In keeping with that approach, I'll start by saying I really love what Peterson and his sinister band of free thinkers, known as the Intellectual Dark Web, is doing to dismantle the social justice movement. If you've read our twice banned article about the religion of leftism, then you already know how we feel about that. Between the rise of intellectuals like Peterson and organizations like Prager University, I really think we're beginning to see a shift in the culture war back towards something that resembles common sense. Now, as far as Peterson's strong Christian leanings, personally, I haven't really figured out if he's doing more harm than good with this. His wishy-washy, take the Bible seriously but not too seriously approach may be distracting a demographic who previously would have sought out actual biblical teachers. On the other hand, it's possible this demographic wouldn't have been attracted to Christianity or the stories in the Bible at all if it weren't for Peterson, in which case his message may be positioning these people to hear from God. These two issues out of the way, I'll tell you the one thing I really value the most about Peterson and others like him. There's an intellectual curiosity present that you don't really find among the majority of Christians and even among our teachers and our leaders. It's a desire to think through things, but not just to think through things, but to struggle with them, with that struggle ultimately manifesting in actively seeking out discussions and debates where you can put those ideas to the test to see how they hold up.
I'd rather not be stupid and wrong if I could help it, because then I don't have to wander into a pit. And so I'm hoping that if we can have a genuine dialogue and we can tell each other the truth, which is the crucial issue here, then I can find out what you know that I don't know, and that'll make me stronger and it'll fortify everyone around me.
When it comes to honesty, introspection, and things like the pursuit of truth, these are areas where I feel the world unfortunately seems to be setting a better example than Christians. Which is really bizarre and somewhat paradoxical, because as humble as Christians seem to be when it comes to acknowledging how sinful and unworthy they are, they often become unreasonably defensive when you suggest they may be wrong about something, or even if you simply want to probe for answers for how they arrived at the interpretations they hold regarding the Bible. Obviously, this isn't everyone, but it is a very large percentage, maybe even the majority. In a world full of hundreds of denominations, we seem to think we are some kind of statistical anomaly. And if we are willing to consider a flaw in our theology, it tends to be over ideas that we're not really emotionally attached to, which means there isn't any real threat of having to be corrected. Some people might object to what I'm saying by pointing out that as Christians, we don't need to be uncertain. We've arrived at the truth. And to suggest that we haven't is to introduce relativism and doubt. But as I've pointed out before, just because we have the truth and we know where to look for it, doesn't mean we know everything we need to know. As the Apostle Paul said, anyone who claims to know all the answers doesn't really know very much. Peterson, when asked which of his 12 rules for life from his wildly successful book does he feel he needs the most work on, his answer was number 9, which is assume that the person you are listening to might know something you don't. I really feel people who pursue debate for this reason, to learn, which really isn't debate, it's a different term known as dialectic, are much better off than those who pursue it to prove someone wrong or don't pursue it at all.
And you know, you can think a little bit, but mostly you're biased and You have confirmation bias and you see things the way you see them and you have massive blind spots and you're ignorant as hell. You just can't think, but you can talk. And the thing is, if you talk, other people will correct you. That's the thing, and that's thinking. So if you get up and you have something to say, and you say it stupidly, because of course you will, because what do you know? Then other people will tell you where you're wrong, and then you can learn, right? And then everybody can think. And so what that also means is that to be free to speak, even to tell the truth, means you have to be free to be stupid and ignorant and malevolent and bitter, because that is who you are. That is what you are, because you're flawed.
In a lot of ways, people like Peterson seem more aware of their bias and inability to completely understand the world around them than Christians. Yet, when you read the book of Proverbs, one theme we see again and again is the fool's refusal to listen to wisdom and heed correction. It's a lesson we're all in need of learning, and I, for one, don't mind being open to whoever happens to be teaching it.
Happens in Genesis because God uses the Logos, which is truthful speech, to cast the pre-cosmogonic potential into habitable order. And then he says it's good. And there's a hint there, right? Because you think, well, is habitable order good? Because life is very difficult. And it's a real question whether or not the order that we inhabit is good. And the hypothesis in the Old Testament is that if truthful speech gives rise to the order, then that order will be good. And that's really something, man. Like, that's really something to apprehend. It's a fundamental theological presupposition that the way that you take the potential upon which the cosmos is predicated and cast it into the order that allows everyone to thrive is by using truthful speech. Wouldn't it be something if that was the case? And the thing is, you know it's the case. You know it. You know it. Because you do not admire yourself if you're deceitful. You admire yourself when you have those rare moments in your life where you can actually stand up and say what's true, regardless of the cost.